book of Haggai this morning, so if you would turn in your scriptures to that little book, that would be helpful. You have in your respective seats a handout, 6 pages. I've got a long version and a short version of this message. This is the short version, but I wanted to give you at least some resources to take home with you, because I will not be covering everything that's before you. Let me just open with a word of prayer. Father, I come before you and acknowledge my utter dependence upon you as I come to your holy and inerrant word. May what is said be empowered by your Spirit. May it be faithful to your word. May it be edifying to all who are here. In Jesus' name, amen.
Amen.
Let me set the stage for you. This little book, one of the minor prophets. There are three of the minor prophets that are post-exilic after the southern tribes had been given permission to return and to rebuild the temple in Jerusalem: Haggai, Zechariah, and Malachi. And we're going to be in Haggai this morning. But they just set the stage about 520 B.C. James Montgomery Boyce, just a brief excerpt from some words that he had about this: gone, as he characterized it, was the glory of the former kingdom. Gone was the temple and the great population that had once been there. All that was left was rubble of Jerusalem, a remnant of the people, and the task of restoration. Difficult job before them. You have a timeline there before you, but what had happened, they had been given permission under the hand of God to return back to restore, to rebuild Jerusalem. And these are the good guys. These are the several hundred thousand that were exiled, but about 50,000 that came back. These are the guys in the white hat, so to speak. They were fulfilling the mission, and yet they struggled. They came back, and 2 years into the process of rebuilding the temple, things came to a grinding halt. And Haggai was commissioned of the Lord to come and speak to the people and to speak the words of God to them to reinvigorate the work. They had become derailed. They had become ineffective. They, frankly, ineffective as a euphemism, they were disobedient. And so the word of God was to be spoken into their lives. And what I have before you is really a synopsis of two chapters. I've got 9 points. They're related. You may consolidate them into 6 or 7, or you may say there's more, but I've got 9 points here. In ministry, it's possible. It happens. It happened to Israel. We become derailed. I remember when I took my son Jeff to the Master's, what was then Master's College, I said as we were dropping him off, I said, "Son, there's 3 things that can derail you in ministry. You can become distracted, you can become defiled, or you can become discouraged, or all 3 of those." And it turns out later that was really a synopsis of what the Apostle Paul was saying to his protege Timothy as he gave him a section of scripture that's reproduced for you in your handout. As he was about to go home to be with the Lord, the Apostle Paul, he spoke to Timothy, who had a very daunting task to carry on the baton that the Apostle Paul was entrusting him to be faithful. How do you avoid becoming derailed in ministry? And he said, "Suffer with me. Be prepared for difficult times, for hard times." And he gave him 3 metaphors, a soldier, an athlete, and a farmer. The soldier entangles himself and he wants to please the one who commissioned him in everyday life so that he pleases the commanding officer. He doesn't become embroiled or entangled or wound up in everyday life as a civilian. He's commissioned. He has a single-minded focus. The athlete must compete according to the rules. We can think of examples of Olympic athletes who have seemingly won the gold medal only to have that medal stripped of them because they had
Wow.
They have to compete according to the rules. The third thing that he said is that a hardworking farmer ought to be the first to receive a share of the crops. You can drive to Springfield, you go up I-55, and the one thing I've never seen on either side are benches or sidelines where people are cheering the farmers. I see them working all day long, and yet I don't see any grandstands. I've never seen that. They just labor. They know what they have to do. No one is applause. No applause. No recognition. They're there. They have a task before them, and so they know that they can't become discouraged. They have to be faithful. Really, it's a matter of priorities if you're going to avoid becoming entangled with the affairs of everyday life. It's a matter of purity if you're going to compete according to the rules. And it's a matter of perspective if you're going to labor unto the Lord and not be caught up in seeking the applause of men. Mm. So all of these things are very important to avoid becoming derailed in ministry. Every single one of these things happened to Israel. Every single one of them. They had become entangled in the affairs of everyday life. They'd lost their priority. They'd become defiled in a very serious way. The priests were lectured about the importance of personal holiness. And certainly, I think the primary strategy that the enemy had used in their lives and even their own flesh was discouragement. They had 14 years of inactivity. And so Haggai is commissioned to speak truth into their life. And all of these things that they were suffering from, they had lost sight of their mission. They had become idolatrous. You can see that in the books of Ezra. You can see it in Nehemiah. And they certainly had become discouraged by the immensity of the task, the smallness, if you will, of what they had been able to accomplish, and the opposition of the enemy. All of them were about them. So how do you persevere? How do you avoid becoming derailed in difficult times and discouraging times? And Haggai, I believe, gives us a case study in how we can persevere, how we can be faithful and serve the Lord well. I'm going to point out, just as we go through this little book, some verses along the way, and it just observations. My thesis is very simple, that the way that we battle discouragement, becoming derailed in ministry, essentially is a function of how we answer a number of key questions in our lives. And the first question is who or what are you listening to in determining what you're going to be doing? There are many voices that speak into your lives, and every day you are hearing the voices of our culture. Every day you are hearing the voices of materialism, the voices of expediency, frankly the voices of immorality. Many voices are speaking into your life. What's your authority? I'm not asking what is your textbook answer. I think without exception we would say the Bible is my authority. Your real functional authority is determined and manifested in how you process decisions in difficult times. That will show what your real authority is. Mm-hmm. We all would profess that this book is our authority. And that's the textbook answer, and that's the right answer. What's your real authority? And who are you listening to? What are you listening to? Mm. Chapter 1, verses 2 and 5. Verse 2, thus speaks the Lord of hosts, saying, this people says, the time has not come, the time that the Lord's house is to be rebuilt. The people were saying, well, the Lord had spoken. He said to return. The Lord of hosts had commissioned them, but the people were saying, the time has not yet come. Now, understand, they were not saying, we're not going to rebuild. They're saying that not now. Mm. I had a pastor years ago, Rodney Storch, a dear friend and now with the Lord. And he said often, and it's true, slow obedience is disobedience. And that's exactly what had happened in their lives. They were listening to a number of voices. You can look at circumstances, and the circumstances in their lives were opposition. Ezra 4 talks about the opposition of the neighboring forces, neighboring peoples. It was not a minor item in their lives. It was significant. There were times of economic struggle. And so what do you do when you're facing these things? How do you make decisions? Sometimes we look at circumstances and we choose the easy path. Sometimes we choose the path of least resistance. Sometimes we choose the worldly wise choice that makes sense. There is a way that seems right to a man, but the end thereof, Scripture says, is death. So this book will tell you how you are to walk. And so the question is, what's your authority? Not the textbook answer, but what has God said? They had rationalized. They had said the time has not yet come. 14 years into this and the time had not yet come. They had constructed something in their mind. The hand of the Lord must not be on this because we were facing opposition. The hand of the Lord must not be among us because the resources aren't here. We're struggling. Rationalization. What are you listening to? where's your focus? Verse 4. And the scripture says, is it time for you yourselves to dwell in your paneled houses? And this house, this temple, lies in ruins. Michael Barrett wrote a very helpful commentary on the minor prophets, the post-exilic prophets. And in the chapter where he was dealing with this particular section, he captioned it, "It's not all about you." And that really captures the essence. Their mind had become focused upon themselves. They had become very myopic in their focus. This house that you were commissioned to come and build is in ruins, and yet you're living in paneled houses. And the question is, where is our focus? John Piper, and I don't have time to go through all of this, that's why I've reproduced it for you in your handout, but the question, if we're going to have a kingdom focus, is what is it in our lives that we really are seeking with all of our heart to make much of? What is it that occupies and our passions of our heart? And he says, if we don't ask that question day by day, we'll gravitate into much of the same things that everybody else around us is making much of. And so we have to ask that question, where is the king in my life? The King of Kings. And where is my focus? And they had lost their focus. They had clearly become derailed. He goes on to say, page 3 of your handout, he says, I have to battle this every day against drifting. It isn't about making choices so much. It's about becoming comfortable with the things that aren't essential to the war effort. It's something that we drift into. They had succumbed to comfort. They had literally drifted into disobedience. It's not as if on one morning they woke up and said, we're not going to build this house that God has sent us back. They had been listening to the voices around them. They had looked at the circumstances. They had lost their focus. They had drifted into disobedience. The scripture tells us that we're made for God's glory. We were to seek his glory. And in chapter 1, verse 8, the scripture says that God is to be glorified. He says, go up to the mountains, the Lord of hosts says. Bring wood, build the temple that I may take pleasure in it and be glorified. What was their mission? The tactical answer was to build a temple. The ultimate answer was that God be glorified, that he be pleased in their lives. And so that really should be our focus, to seek first the kingdom of God and all that that represents, and all of these other things will be added unto us. It's always a matter of the heart. I've got a quotation for you here from John Newton, and he talks about the difference between outward obedience and the steps that we show in our lives and the real heart focus that we have. He says, the difference between obeying rules of outward conduct rather than setting the heart on Christ as your peace in your life. It's possible to deceive ourselves by looking at our outward conduct into thinking that Christ is preeminent. If he is truly occupying the throne in our lives experientially, if our heart is glued to him and satisfied in him and preoccupied with him, that will show itself in our behavior. But it's possible to have behavior that looks like it's in conformity, but the heart sometimes is very far away. The third question that we have to ask is, what's happening in your life? Maybe you're facing disappointments. It's a matter of expectations. We all have certain expectations. We live in a world that is full of an entitlement mentality. I'm entitled to have a good life. I'm entitled to have all of these great opportunities and an easy street type life. But the scripture tells us that we should expect opposition. Yeah. I remember when my son was just a young guy and he was playing soccer and not particularly talented in soccer. He had other skills in hockey that he was much better at, but he got the ball. He was just a young guy, 6 years old or 5 or so. But he had the ball and no one was trying to kick the ball out. He'd gotten turned around. And he was heading toward the wrong goal. And fortunately, somebody came up, one of his teammates, and kicked the ball away. If you're not facing opposition, it's very possible that you're heading toward the wrong goal. That's right. And if you're heading toward the right goal, you should expect opposition. So what are your expectations? What are your expectations? Expect challenges. James 1, I love the Phillips paraphrase. He says, when all sorts of trials and temptations crowd into your lives, don't resent them as intruders, but welcome them as friends. Those are the tools that God uses in our lives. Difficult times. We shouldn't resent difficult times. We should see them as things that God is using. We should not despise the discipline of the Lord when He is chastening us. He loves us. If we have no discipline and no chastening in our lives, then we're not being treated as children. Why are we not being disciplined for our sin? We should ask ourselves that question. So what are your expectations? In tough times, what is God teaching you? It may not always be possible to ascertain the answer with crystal clarity, but often we can. In chapter 1, verse 9 through 11, the answer is given. God says, I'm doing this to you. He says, if you're wondering why you're going through difficult times, you looked for much, but it came to little. And when you brought it home, I blew it away. Mm-hmm. Why, says the Lord of hosts? Because of my house, it's in ruins, while every one of you runs to his own house. Therefore, the heavens above you withhold the dew, and the earth withholds its fruit. I called for a drought. You can read the rest. God says, I'm doing this. Mm-hmm. There was no ambiguity about this. What is God teaching you? In this case, the answer was very clear. Why were they struggling? Because they were disobedient. Mm-hmm. And God says, I'm doing this in your life. Is it possible when you're encountering difficult times that God may be building your character? Is it possible that He may be pruning you? Is it possible that He may be chastening you and shaping you into the character of Christ? So the question would be, what's happening in your life? And when you're encountering disappointments, what is God teaching you? I'm reminded of a poem that Jim Elliot would often cite, written by Amy Carmichael, a woman who went to India, the dawn of her fellowship. She literally gave her life away for little children in India. And the poem, only an excerpt here, no wound, no scar. Yet as the master shall the servant be, and pierced are the feet that follow me. But thine are whole. Can he have followed far who has no wound or scar? If we're following in the footsteps of Jesus and our feet are whole, so we should ask ourselves, what path am I really following? Because as the master, so shall the servant be. Fourth question is, what would God have you do in response to your circumstances? And the answer is very clear. Chapter 1, verse 8, that the Lord God of hosts says to them three things. Go up to the mountains, bring wood, build a temple that I may take pleasure in it and be glorified. They had succumbed to inertia, 14 years of inertia. That's a nice word for sin. That's a nice word for disobedience. They had become stymied in their progress. They literally had lost their passion. When we come alongside someone who is struggling in their lives, there's a place for empathy. There's a place for weeping with those who weep. There's a time for coming alongside, examining your own hearts first to strengthen the one who's in sin. But at the end of the day, the best thing we can do for someone who is in disobedience is to speak truth into their life, and that means to be directive to them. And the answer that God gave them was, get up, get wood, and get moving. The answer to disobedience is obedience. It's not to wallow in self-pity. It's not to become stymied and everything. God gave them three imperatives. Get up, go to the top of the mountain, get wood, and come and build. Mm-hmm. It was very clear. So the scripture is clear. The one thing we have the Holy Spirit to give us understanding of the scriptures. We believe in the perspicuity, the clarity of scripture. We believe in the illuminating work of the Holy Spirit. We believe in the authority of the Word of God. And often the Word of God speaks truth to us. It's like, what do I do? Get up and get moving. If you find yourself in a time of disobedience, and the answer is not to analyze your disobedience, the answer is to obey. But we need to understand what contributed to it, but God speaks truth into our lives. Get up, get wood, and get moving, building. Do we really have confidence in the Word of God? Literally, what happened was in 23 days, suddenly there had been a revival. Suddenly they're building again. Mm-hmm. What had happened? The truth of God had been spoken into their lives. and changes were occurring. Hearts had been changed. The Spirit of God was working by and through the Word of God and affecting the plan of God. And he was bringing conviction and courage and activity. Do you really believe that God uses his Word? Here's an example that they suddenly got all turned around. And you can see it in verse 14. They turned around. Chapter 1, verse 10. The Lord stirred up the spirit of Zerubbabel, the son of Shealtiel, governor of Judah, and the spirit of Joshua, the son of Jehozadak, the high priest, and the spirit of all the remnant of the people. Who stirred them up? God did. How did he do that? He worked through the preaching of his word. And what did they do? They came and they worked on the house of the Lord. 4 years later, it's built. Do you believe that God works by and through his word? If you don't, you're in the wrong place. You must believe that God works by and through his word. And he does work by and through. It is his word. And the Spirit brings conviction and action on the part of the people of God. Here's a prime example, a complete turnaround in what was happening. Do you believe in the power of the word of God? The fifth question is, what are you looking at chapter 2, verse 3, so they're beginning to work. The things are looking good. And then in chapter 2, verse 3, you have a group of people, a remnant of the people, saying, who is left among you who saw this temple in its former glory? And how do you see it now? In comparison with it, is this not in your eyes as nothing? This is the peril of the good old days. This is the peril of comparisons. How do you evaluate what God is doing in your life and through your life and in ministry? Comparisons can be absolutely deadly. When we begin to look at, well, my congregation's 45 people, the guy down the street, he's got 750. Well, comparisons. The church used to be bigger than it is now. Well, okay. You can, all sorts of comparisons. They were saying, well, this temple, it doesn't even bear a resemblance. It's just a shadow of his former glory. How does God evaluate our work? Is it in the magnitude of our work or in the faithfulness of our work? Mm-hmm. It's in the faithfulness of our work. Who do we trust to make the outcome and to evaluate what we do? God. The metric is not numbers. There's a saying in church circles about nickels and noses. You've probably heard that. That's death to a pastor. When you become fixated on the size of your congregation and your revenue stream and your budget, and you get all fixated on this and suddenly it doesn't meet your standards, the question is, are you faithfully proclaiming the word of God? Are you shepherding the flock of God among you? Are you loving the flock? Are you caring for them? Are you laboring for them in prayer? Are you serving them? Are you doing what God has called you to do? If so, quit making comparisons. And just persevere and do the work. Because there will always be those who say, well, this is not an impressive thing. And by someone's standards, it's always unimpressive. But it's not the important thing is whose standard are we using? It's God's standard that really, really matters. So what are you looking at? What's your standard? Next question is where's your strength? Chapter 2, verse 4. Yet now, be strong, Zerubbabel, says the Lord. Be strong, Joshua,